You are listening to Packers Talk Radio Network.
PackersTalk.com.
This Green Bay Packers podcast is brought to you by Mayfield Sports Marketing, our official sports marketing agent for player appearances. To book a Packers player for your next event, go to PackersTalk.com and click on Player Appearances. Are you looking for some signed Packer memorabilia?
Look no further than Waukesha Sports Cards.
If the Green Bay Packer can sign it, Waukesha Sports Cards has it.
Check our website for upcoming Packer player and legend signings.
Go to WaukeshaSportsCards.com.
Are you ready for my nightmare scenario with the Giants?
No, I'm not, well,
I'm going to throw it out there anyways, because I tweeted this the other day. I was like, you know, I don't know if people are going to think I'm crazy. And I couldn't believe all the responses I got from people who were like, I agree, I'm still terrified of the Giants. My nightmare scenario for this Packers team is that they go like 13-3, get the number one seed in the NFC. The Giants trudge it out in a crappy NFC East to like a 9-7 record, get the four seed as the division winner, beat like the Vikings in round one at home, and then come into Lambeau for a divisional round matchup.
Oh, boy.
We have seen big plays from Aaron Rodgers.
I'm at your service.
All season long.
Last tempo, we got to bring some energy and some life.
Omega Donuts Podcast.
We got to get this thing amped up.
With them great guys, Chris and Adam. Even Aaron likes them.
Are you kidding me? I love them.
Not just my spare tire. So Lord, I ask him, be my guide and force the truth. Some strange reason it had to be. He guided me to Tennessee.
Take me to another place. Take me to another land. Make me forget all the hurts. Let me understand your plans.
Hello, Packer Nation, old big and old listeners and followers. I'm Adam Somers, joined by my bestest friend in the world, Chris Lempesis, fresh off his mountain vacation. We took our bye week a week early.
Yeah, we took our bye week during the season, and then now when maybe other people are taking a break, we're back at it. Which is a little strange, but that kind of fits our style, so it works.
Yeah, I'm
back. I was in Tennessee for my honeymoon.
Tennessee?
What up, Tennessee? I was...
Or Arrested Development.
Yeah, I was in some... I had some good times down there on the honeymoon. I'm back now, ready to talk some Packers. I saw so much. You know what's crazy to me? And I think we've talked about this before, about how, like, Packer fans really are just everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everywhere you go. And I just, this trip was another reminder of that. Because, you know, I live in suburban Milwaukee. So, you know, we're driving, you know, you go down through Illinois and Indiana and Kentucky and into Tennessee, and I can't even tell you how many times I just had random people walk, because I wear my Packer hat most of the trip, or, you know, I'm wearing my Eddie Lacy J shirt, and people are just like, go Pack. I was at a rest stop in Indiana, right, coming out of the bathroom, and I was going to get a drink from the water fountain, and it was like one of those two-headed ones or whatever. There's like two kind of put together, I don't know. You know what I'm trying to say? There are like two water fountains. So I'm getting a drink at mine. And this dude, this old guy walks out. He's not wearing any Packer gear. This old guy walks out of the bathroom, comes over to the water fountain next to mine, starts getting a drink. And we both kind of pull up at the same time. And without saying anything, he just looks at me and goes, I think we're going to win on Sunday. This is before the Rams game.
Yeah.
He just goes, I think we're going to win on Sunday. And I was like, what? And he's like, the Pack. Go Pack. And I was like, oh, yeah. It just caught me off guard because, you know, that would happen in Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
But you wouldn't expect that would happen somewhere in rural Indiana.
No.
But it was just like, shit, man, Packer fans were everywhere.
And you saw a few down in Nashville, too.
I did. Thanks to the recommendations of some of our Twitter followers, I went to the Scoreboard Bar and Grill in Nashville to watch the Rams game.
Mm-hmm.
That was fun. Talked to some Southerners. They liked my Clay Matthews jersey. Old school. You could smoke in this bar.
Oh, so they're still pro-cancer down in the South.
Yeah, you could smoke. They had a cigarette machine. I was like, holy shit. It's like, these things are like dinosaurs where I'm from.
Yeah.
They had a cigarette machine. You could smoke. It was great. It was packed. Those people were so intense. It was great. And then we went out that night after the Rams game in downtown Nashville. the Bills were playing the Titans that day. The Bills won. So literally, like, the entire city of Buffalo was in downtown Nashville that night.
And Buffalo's got their fans have gotten a lot of pub this year. They seem to go a little nuts.
They do. It was they were wild. They're friendly as shit. I'll tell you what, the Bills fans, they were all everyone that we talked to was nice. But then we even down there people were going, go Pack, yeah, go Pack. And then I did. My wife and I were leaving a bar. This is a funny sequence. We were leaving a bar. As we were walking out, we basically walked right into the middle of a fight between Bills fans and Titans fans, which you wouldn't think there'd be any animosity, but I think because everybody was drunk and the bar was right near the stadium. So we kind of had to scurry out. And then as I'm walking down the street in Nashville, I pass this guy and he looks really familiar. And I'm like, I'm not going to lie, I was drunk. And I'm like, hey, I think that was Ty Dunn. Former Milwaukee Journal Sentinel writer, now with the Buffalo News, I think. Yeah, Buffalo News. And I get a few steps past him, and I'm like, well, I'm drunk. I'm going to go say hi. So I walk over, and I'm like, hi, excuse me. And he's waiting to get in line at this bar where the bar fight was. And I'm like, hi, excuse me. You're Ty Dunn, right? And he goes, yeah. He goes, and you are? And I'm like, I'm Chris Lempesis. I'm half of this Twitter account, Old Bag of Donuts. And he looks at me. I'm not kidding you, Adam. He looks at me. He goes, wait a minute. The Bag of Donuts? And I'm like, oh, you know how to make a lady feel nice. So we talked for a while. So he and I, my wife, are talking on the street as this bar fight is like spilling out into the street. And he thinks the Packers are going to go to the Super Bowl. So that was.
Well, the NFC is kind of it's opened up a little bit. And we'll get into that.
Yeah, and because I was just like, well, how do you like the job? He's like, oh, I love it. I'm like, yeah, I know you're from that area, and it must be nice to be back home. And he's like, yeah, I miss it, you know. And he's like, I miss being around Tom and Bob and everybody. And you guys were all great. All the people on Packers Twitter were always super nice. He's like, plus, I mean, they are going to – he's like, I mean, they're going to the Super Bowl, so I'm going to miss not covering that. And I was like, oh, you think they're going? He's like, yeah. He's like, they're going. I was like, all right. Well, that makes me feel good.
So we got that endorsement.
I was like, well, that makes me feel good. So anyways, if you're still listening, those are some of my tales from being DC.
So the Chargers game, you got home enough time to watch that, right?
Yeah, I did. We got home, just like an hour before the game. I caught the end of the shitstorm that was Bears-Lions.
I am so, living in Minneapolis, this is the nightmare I had to live through. Well, actually, it wasn't a nightmare. It was actually kind of positive.
Oh, because okay.
So I didn't have to live through Bears-Lions. I lived through Vikings-Chiefs, which wasn't Alan Gasman. It wasn't really that intriguing, but I had a couple guys fantasy football purposes that I had to pay attention to in that game. So that game got over really quick. It was over by before 3 o'clock. It was a really, really quick game. Sweet. I have time before the Packers game's on, because it wasn't until 3:25. Well, then they switched coverage to the Broncos and Browns, because there's a lot of people in the Twin Cities that want to watch the Broncos and Browns duke it out in overtime.
See, people were going off about this on Twitter, and I was like, oh, I guess because, you know, I guess I take it for granted now living in Milwaukee, a Packers market, that it's like literally right when it got to 3:20, they cut out of that game and went to the Packer game.
But because
people on Twitter were just going berserk, tweeting at CBS and their local affiliates. They're like, please drop this shit and click over to the Packer game.
Because that's what
happened. You had that too then.
The Vikings game ended probably right around 3 o'clock.
The Viking game was quick. That was a quick game, yeah.
And didn't go into overtime, and then they did their kind of studio recap of the game, and I'm like, okay, they're just going to do the studio show. I didn't expect them to cut over. Well, they cut over for extra bonus coverage, Broncos and Browns overtime, and they did this a couple weeks ago when there was 4 games that went to overtime. That was a lot of fun, because I saw the ending of 3 different games. And then I just assumed at 3:25, being the Chargers-Packers game, this is going to go to Nash, they're going to switch to the national game. They're going to cut out of the overtime game. No, they didn't. Basically missed the first two drives of the game. I'm just like, what the hell is going on here? there's nothing I can do. I'm like, well, I'm not going to run the freaking bar for 2 minutes to watch this. And so I just sat on Twitter, and I didn't really bitch about it because enough people are doing that already. And then I just kind of followed along and had my fancy app on my phone and just held out.
Because that game went really long. Didn't it go to halfway through overtime before Denver finally won?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
There was only like 5 minutes left to go in overtime when that game ended.
Yeah, people were
missed the first two drives of the game, so not the end of the world in the grand scheme of it all. Didn't miss really anything at all. But it was still annoying enough. It kind of like it's the good and bad of cutting. It's like I don't have Red Zone channel, and I really wish I did because I would never leave the couch.
It's pretty.
2 weeks. But 2 weeks ago, when they beat the Rams, that game ended pretty early too.
That game, yeah.
And that was a week there was like three overtime games. So they just kept cutting overtime. They kept cutting the Chiefs and Bears game, and then there was the Bengals Seahawks game, and there was another game that went into overtime. Oh, it was Ravens and Browns. So that was fun to watch all these, but the Packers game was already over with.
Right.
So now I saw the reverse fact of it. It sucks.
That's one of my favorite things when the Packers play at noon and win, and then you get the bonus coverage.
Mm-hmm.
You just feel like you're on top of the world as a football fan. You're like, the Packers won, and I'm getting extra coverage right now.
Yeah, there's nothing better.
It's great. It's awesome. So also awesome are 6-0 Green Bay Packers, Adam.
Yes, that's the number I keep going back to this week is 6-0 because I want to gauge your pulse after that game, like immediately after the game. And so Sunday night, how did you feel? And then all of a sudden, now 5 days later, how do you feel?
I feel good. You know, I think I was a little bit. I mean, how do I say this? As the game is going on and Philip Rivers is piling up the passing yards and the offense is struggling, I mean, I didn't feel that great about it. And when they won, I felt more relieved than happy. But then sort of as Sunday night went on, I started feeling better about it. And now we're sitting here on Thursday night doing our bye week extravaganza, and I still feel pretty good about it. I mean, it's like I said during the game on Twitter, or it was right after the game. I was like, this team that we're watching right now isn't going to be great. They're too beat up. You know what I mean? There's too many injuries. Like, they'll show you spurts of being great, but they're not going to be able to do it consistently until everybody's healthy. So that being said, the fact that they're still able to gut these wins out, I feel good about that.
Yeah, I feel...
How about you? How do you feel?
I feel a lot better now than I did 5 days ago. I'm not going to lie about that. Like, it's a good week for the bye week. This team's just so banged up. I'm not as concerned about as I was about the pass defense. I think that's going to get better. I think it's just one of those games where it just got piled on and piled on. I don't think San Diego uncovered anything the rest of the NFL doesn't know already.
Right.
They're going to get Morgan Burnett back. Shields, I think, will be 100% after the bye week. They're going to get healthy all around. And I think the loss of B.J. Raji meant a lot more than people really, really talked about.
I agree.
Because just because San Diego didn't run the ball doesn't mean Raji can't be a factor. However, on Sunday night, though, I wasn't about to say this team sucks, they're not going to win the division, they're not going to make the playoffs, the sky is falling, but I had major concerns Sunday night.
I thought you might have because we have our little three-way group text, me and you and our old pal Gene Bossling, and Gino asked us how we were feeling after the game, and you didn't respond. And I was like, I'm thinking Adam might not be that jazzed up right now because he's not responding.
No, I wasn't. And I'm still not that jazzed up.
You
saw the bad of Dom Capers and a little bit of the bad of Mike McCarthy, who failed to change anything to stop Phil Rivers. You saw towards the end of this first half, once Gordon went down, that, okay, they're just going to chuck it all over the field. What can you do to combat this? And they didn't do anything. So if Capers coaches like this, they face a team like the Arizona Cardinals or the Atlanta Falcons in the playoffs, they're done. They're done. I'm still kind of negative about it. Now, am I going to panic? I saw some fans on Twitter kind of panicking. Some of our friends that I text with were panicking. I'm like, nah, it's a 6-0. They got a bye week. They're banged up. It's still early in the year. This is not like it's week. It's not like this is week 16 in Arizona and this is happening.
Right.
Because I would be a lot more worried then, but wasn't thrilled about it. Still not. I think it was kind of a fluke, but at the same time, it really wasn't a fluke because we've seen this defense be this way so many times in the past. And we thought we corrected this problem by drafting Clinton Dix, by drafting Rollins and Randall, by improving the pass rush, by getting guys healthy. And whatever was working early in this year was working, and all of a sudden it kind of revert back to the past events we've seen in so many years under Dom Capers.
I agree. I think – I was thinking about this today because I knew we were going to record tonight. And I was like, you know, I was thinking about the defense. I was like, you know, it's kind of a tough thing to make up my mind on because I'm like, you know, on the one hand, they are banged up. You know, they didn't have Raji or Burnett or Perry, who has been having was having a really good season up until he got hurt. But, like, you know, Raji, they didn't have those three last week. And then they didn't have those three for most of the Rams game, right? Like, Burnett didn't play, and then Raji and Perry got hurt fairly early on. So, really, that trio has been missing for the last 2 weeks. So, part of me is like, well, those three guys, when added up, are pretty freaking important. Is it the absence of those guys that's leading up to this, or is it Dom's defense slipping back? Because here's the thing that does worry me, even if we give this team a mulligan sort of for the injuries on defense.
Yeah.
The thing that worries me is they played the Rams, right? You knew the Rams were going to run the hell out of the football, and you couldn't stop it. You had a pretty good feeling the Chargers were going to throw the hell out of the football. And you couldn't stop it, right? Mm-hmm. So that's where I'm torn. I'm like, is it the injuries or is it, you know what I mean? Is it just Dom, like you said, slipping back into his old ways?
That's what concerns me the most. Not so much the actual players and the injuries, because that's going to correct itself. It's Dom Capers. Did he coach over his head the first 5 weeks of the season? And is the Packers' best football and the Packers' best defensive football behind him? Did this defense peak too early? And the fact that there's no adjustments being made, if there was any adjustments being made 2 weeks ago against St. Louis, there was any adjustments being made last week against San Diego, and both teams took it to this defense in two completely separate ways.
Right, and like that's like I'm saying, in separate ways, but with their bread and butter. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, everybody knew, and Dom knew, Dom's a smart guy. Dom knew St. Louis was going to limit Nick Foles' impact on the game. They were going to run the hell out of that football. Packers did nothing to stop it. And then
when Melvin Gordon got hurt, there was no way that they weren't going to pass the football. And you see me saw in the first half. I mean,
right.
Remember how many passes did he attempt at by halftime?
Right.
Like, it was so obvious that was the game plan. It was early on.
Right. So that's where I'm like, well, yeah, it would have been nice to have those guys. But at the same time, and they, like I said, they would have made a difference, but how much of a difference? I don't know. Like, I still feel like even if you have Raji and Burnett and Perry healthy, I still think Gurley runs for over 100, which
yeah,
isn't good.
And I'm sure.
And I don't think Rivers hits 500, but he probably throws for 300
yeah.
or 350. And I'm like, that ain't really good either. That's with a full deck. So I'm not feeling as high on this defense as I was 2 weeks ago, but you know, they can certainly win me back.
Yeah, I don't think the sky is falling. It's just
you have no. I mean? It's like you were saying yesterday when we were texting. You have concerns.
Yeah, if this happened in week 15 or 16, yeah, I would be flipping mad and outrageous right now. I'd be in panic mode. However, it's week 6. They got a bye week coming up. I mean, it's week 7, and they have enough time to get these guys healthy and correct it. It's just, can Dom correct it? I mean, I think, is this team a top 5 defense as we kind of hope they would be? And like, holy crap, they might be early this year? No. But where does the mean fall on this defense? Where does the pendulum fall? Are they also a bottom 10 defense, which they have been in years past? Or do they kind of even themselves out and they're a top 10, top 12 defense?
Which I think is your hope.
Yes.
Your hope is that this team, if this team can finish 12th or 13th in overall defense, we're going to be okay. And I think the other problem with this team, with the defense too, is on the other side of the ball. Like, the Packers defense, I think, played so well those first 4 weeks because the offense was always putting them in advantageous spots. Like, I think part of the defense's shortcomings these last 2 weeks is injuries. Part of it's Dom Capers, and I think part of it is the offense has just been not good. This has not been a good offense, really, since the Kansas City game.
Yeah, let's not
we can't absolve the offense from this because, you know, I was willing to give them a pass on the San Francisco game because it was like short week, you got to travel across the country. It's hot. I get that. But the last 2 weeks at home, where this offense is normally so good, they haven't been. And again, I get injuries are a part. Yeah. Injuries are a part of that, but at the same time,
you still got the best player in the world at the helm,
who has not played like the best player in the world the last few weeks.
No, Rodgers not winning MVP this year. I think that's pretty much clear unless he goes 16-0.
He hasn't been terrible, you know. And I said during the game on Twitter, I was like, you know, it's been 3 weeks like this now with Rodgers. I go, it's not that he's been terrible. I mean, he wasn't very good. He was kind of terrible against St. Louis. But, like, he hasn't been terrible overall. He just hasn't been what we're used to. And people were, you know, so defensive about it. And people were tweeting at me and saying, well, his receivers can't get open. And I'm like, it's okay to criticize. I mean, we've said this on the show before. It's okay to criticize Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah. The fact that San Diego had the ball for 10, 15 minutes more than the Packers did last week, that falls a lot on number 12. And also on the head coach. I mean, Phil Rivers throwing the ball 60 times for 500 yards. You give him that much time of possession, yeah, any good quarterback league is going to put up those stats. It's the time of possession really worried me. Starks had a nice game, but you take away a couple of his bigger runs, they couldn't sustain any really real drives in this game.
No, and I think some of that falls on the play calling too. I mean, you heard TJ Lang. I think it was in the Journal Sentinel. I can't remember who wrote it, but he was saying that there was frustration on the sidelines amongst the offensive linemen.
Yeah.
But they were running the shit out of the ball, and whenever they did run it, but, I mean, it wasn't something that they went to. They went fairly pass-heavy, which seems silly because San Diego has one of the worst run defenses in football, but I guess we shouldn't be too
Again,
surprised.
Adapting, and they didn't do it.
I have some issues. You know, it's funny, if we're just sort of using this as an event session, which people are probably like, God,
sure.
You're probably like, is this team 3-3?
Well, they might as well be.
We're happy with where they're at. It's just there are some issues. My big issue here.
This team could go 7-9 real easy. 7-9. I'm just kidding. I'm just trying to get people going.
I have a couple of issues with the way that they've handled these injured players on offense, namely Eddie Lacy. Lacy gets hurt in week 2 against Seattle and has, outside of the second half against San Francisco, has just been a shell of what he normally is. You know, and I know he's a tough guy and he wants to play through it because he's done it before. And he wasn't on the injury report. I got people tweeting, well, he wasn't on the injury report last week. I'm like, yeah, his ankle's hurt. We all know that. We can all see something's wrong with Lacy. People are now starting to point at his conditioning and saying that he's out of shape. I don't think that's the case, even though I know McGinn wrote the other day that some personnel people think he's as high as 260 pounds.
Well, I mean, I think that does play with a little bit of his injury. It's if you have a lower body injury, it's tough to stay in shape when you're kind of already a big dude like Lacy is and stay conditioned when you can't do anything.
Yeah, I suppose that's true. What I mean to say is just that I don't think the weight is so much. I think it's the ankle. I just think his ankle is really hurt. Now, let's look at that with regards to Sunday. You kept Alonzo Harris on your roster over Rajon Neal, who outperformed Harris by about 7 miles in the preseason. You kept Harris because he was Diet Lacy, as I called him on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
He is, you know, he's a poor man's Lacy, a big physical back who doesn't maybe have breakaway speed, but is fast enough and can wear a defense down. You kept him as your Eddie Lacy insurance. Wasn't Sunday the perfect time to cash in on that insurance? You could have given Lacy, could have given Lacy Sunday, the bye week. And so it'd be basically 3 weeks between games.
I was just going to say, you can have Lacy basically a 3 week break because you were going to beat the Chargers. You could beat the Chargers without Lacy, and they did beat him without
right.
Lacy because,
right, because
he didn't even play.
He didn't play anyway, and the San Diego's run defense is shit. It was like, You're really telling me Starks and Harris combined can't get the job done against San Diego? Of course they could.
If they could, well, then 12 has to air out 40 times. That's not a bad backup plan either.
Right. So what does Mike do? They play Lacy and then proceed to give him 6 touches, 4 carries and 2 catches. I'm like, what? You just had a golden opportunity to give your running back, the player you and I said before the season that we think is one of the most 3 important players on this football team. They had a chance to give him a 3 week break and get him at least somewhat close to 100% for the second part of your season. And they blew it. And that really pissed me off. That's the thing that has me more upset than anything is the way that they've handled Lacy. And Cobb, too, who you and I have been saying since Cobb got hurt. at some point they're going to have to give Cobb a break. I feel like Sunday would have been that chance. I think they should have on Sunday with him too.
Cobb's a little more difficult because you can – James Starks is one of the best backup running backs in the league. And I mean, Janis played fine, but I think Montgomery and Janis are so unproven right now.
Well, and then Montgomery got hurt, so that would have been
– yeah. But I think there's not really a good – I get what you're saying with Cobb, and we've said it before, but I think at this point without Adams in there, they have to play Cobb.
Yeah, and maybe – you know what? And maybe – yeah, maybe I'm a little harsher on Cobb, but I still think with regards to last Sunday, although I do think at some point – I still think at some point this season Mike's going to have to sit Cobb for a week or two.
And he might, and I think that might be when Adams gets back. It's just – it's tough to do right now. And
because Cobb – I mean, you can just tell. I mean, he dropped that ball early in the game. Cobb never drops passes like that. And it feels like his shoulder is really becoming a factor, you know, which makes sense because he's never rested the damn thing since he hurt it. So, like, I don't know. I have some issues with the way Mike's handled these injured guys on offense.
Yeah.
They're 6-0.
6-0, but it's not a pretty 6-0.
What's the record again? It's 6-0. Everything is good on that front. I still really like where this team is. I'm just saying. We're just pointing out some of the issues we have at the moment.
Well, I would say there is issues with a lot of the undefeated teams. You look at Denver, Manning is really, really bad at football now. You look at Carolina.
I can't wait to talk more about Manning next week because I definitely have some thoughts on that.
Yeah, we'll break down the Broncos game next week. We're kind of doing more of a recap of San Diego this week and then kind of get into a near mid-season recap preview.
Yeah, there you go.
But you look at it, then Carolina's undefeated. They have a lot of issues in offense.
You know, it's funny. Go ahead.
But then again, you look at Cincinnati and New England, both those teams are rolling. So I guess, you know, there's other undefeated teams that have issues.
You know, and I just kind of think – I was listening to Sports Talk Radio here in Milwaukee – on my way home, and they were talking about this. I didn't know this until then. Of the 32 teams in the league, only 10 teams right now have winning records. Like, it's kind of possible that this might just be a down year for the NFL as a whole in terms of, like, overall talent and injuries obviously always play a factor into that, but, like, sort of in terms of the overall quality of this teams, which isn't something that really ever gets discussed, but, like, I think that might be the fact. I think that might be the case this year. There just might not be. This just might not be a very good league this year.
It's a very, I think, almost top-heavy league, and it's crappy parity. But you look at in each conference, there's two or three teams that really stand out from the rest, and then maybe three teams in each conference, and then that's it. And then the drop off is pretty bad. I mean, you look at the NFC. I see the class right now is Carolina and Green Bay undefeated. I think you can throw Arizona.
I was gonna say
I throw
Arizona. I might even throw Atlanta in there.
Yeah, I mean, Atlanta, but then you look in, like, look at the possible teams that could be wild cards in the NFC. Vikings. The Giants, the Cowboys, the Rams.
I'm scared. I don't know if you saw me on Twitter the other day saying this. I'm scared shitless of the New York Giants. I still am.
Yeah, I was going to make a joke there, but... Yeah,
here's my nightmare scenario.
Eli and Odell Beckham go off.
Are you ready for my nightmare scenario with the Giants?
No, I'm not, but go ahead.
I'm going to throw it out there anyways, because I tweeted this the other day. I was like, you know, I don't know if people are going to think I'm crazy, and I couldn't believe all the responses I got from people who were like, I agree, I'm still terrified of the Giants. My nightmare scenario for this Packers team is that they go like 13-3, get the number one seed in the NFC. The Giants trudge it out in a crappy NFC East to like a 9-7 record, get the 4 seed as the division winner, beat like the Vikings in round 1 at home, and then come into Lambeau for a divisional round matchup. And I know this isn't the same Giants team as in years past, but it's still Eli and it's still Coughlin, and damn it, they scare the crap out of me. Anyways, positive. I'm trying to – let's go positive. Back to what I was saying a minute ago. I sidetracked us. Like, they were saying, well, you know, the Packers – they're again, on the Sports Talk Radio I was listening to, they're like, well, you know, the Packers – and a lot's been written about this – 6-0, but their teams they've beaten – the teams they've beaten have an 11-24 record.
So?
Or something. 11-24, I think that's what it is. And then they were like, oh, yeah, but if you look at the rest of the league, it's that way with everybody, too. Like, the teams Denver's beaten Green Bay's victories have come over opponents to combine 11 wins. Denver, 10 wins. So Denver's played even worse competition. I think it was either Carolina or Cincinnati's. I think it might be Carolina. 9 wins?
NFL's just not that good this year.
You know the team? Are you ready for this? The team that stands out in this group, New England, their opponents have a combined 13-16 record. Or was it 13-16? Yeah, 13-16.
That's not that good. I mean, it's...
Right, so it's just, like we said, it's kind of just a top-heavy league with a bunch of crap underneath it.
The Packers keep doing what they're doing. They're going to win the division. They're going to get a first-round bye. They just have to get healthy. I mean, literally, they could go 6-4 the rest of the way. They could go 5-5 the rest of the way, and they're probably getting a first-round bye still.
Yeah.
I don't want them to go 5-5 the rest of the way, but they could, and they're going to be just fine.
It's a tough schedule. You know, I guess you never really think about it while the season's going on because you're sort of, as a fan, always just thinking about the next opponent. But, like, you know, the bye week gives you a chance to kind of look at this stuff. They have some tough games. If people think the Packers have played a cupcake schedule so far, it's anything but for most of the rest of the way, right? At Denver, undefeated. The next week, at Carolina, undefeated. They also have road games at Minnesota, which won't be easy. A road game at Arizona, which is going to be incredibly tough. I would say even the Oakland game I don't think is like a total gimme.
Yeah.
All right, it's probably a gimme. So let's say, screw it. Four really tough road games.
And also don't forget about that mid-December game against Dallas when
Romo and Bryant
and Dez are going to be back by then.
Read my mind, Adam Somers. I was just going to say that Romo and Bryant will be back. I'm going to that game. That's going to be a tough game. So that makes 5 tough games. And then, what is that? 5. And then what do they got? Detroit twice, Chicago.
They got Detroit twice, Chicago, and Minnesota. They got Minnesota twice. So let's just assume they beat Detroit twice because Detroit's a freaking train wreck.
Yep. You know they're going to kill Chicago on Thanksgiving night.
They're going to beat Minnesota at home unless there's nothing to play for. So that's 4 wins right in there. Worst case scenario against the Broncos, Panthers, Cowboys, Vikings, road, and at Cardinals, they go 2-3 in those games.
So we're looking at what? What is 7-3?
Look at 7-3 the rest of the way. They finish 13.
Which is where I think they're going to finish. I feel like 13 wins is probably where this team ends up. And that,
do you see them losing more than 3 games the rest of the year? I really don't.
I don't either. I mean,
it's especially if somehow they can get all the next 2 weeks at Denver, at Carolina, tough as hell, right?
Oh yeah.
If they can get all that 2-0, holy cow. If they can just get all that next 2 weeks 1-1, they're going to be just fine. Especially if that one loss is at Denver and they beat Carolina, well then they pretty much have home field wrapped up at that point.
Yeah, I agree. I'd be happy with the split. And it's funny cuz like I said, people are like, "Well, they haven't played anybody." I'm like, "Well, they're about to." So don't worry. I'm like, "We're going to find out a lot about this team here these next couple of weeks cuz both road games against good teams and that'll be good. Yeah, I agree. I think 13-3 is probably where they finish. It's hard to see them losing any more than 3 games, especially if everybody does get close to being healthy coming out of the bye, which I think maybe outside of Nick Perry, I think they're going to have pretty much all hands on deck. So that's good. You know, I think what we're trying to say is we're excited about this team's projection, but maybe we have some issues with it right now.
We're trying to be as cautious. We're displaying our excitement very cautiously.
Since we're sort of freeform jazzing this thing like we always do, but even more so this week.
Yeah.
I want to toss out something to you. I don't know if had a chance to read Pro Football Talk.
I did. I dabbled.
Your sigh tells me you might know where I'm going with this. Stephen Smith of the Baltimore Ravens.
Yes.
Is dead set on retiring at the end of the year. The Ravens are hot garbage. Florio writes that if the Ravens really are dead, they should do everything they can to trade Steve Smith to a contender. And who do you think the first team Florio suggested was? The Green Bay Packers. Which is funny because I suggested it to one of the guys from Acme Packing Company on Twitter during the game on Sunday. Not that I knew anything, but I was just like, you know, the lack of a deep threat is kind of the one thing that worries me with this receiving core, even when Adams gets healthy in Montgomery. Would Ted call about Steve Smith? And then to see Florio write that last night, I was like, oh my God, someone else thinks that too.
A conditional 6th or 7th round pick.
Because you got to think Baltimore's not going to – Baltimore can't ask for too much because he's retiring.
Yeah, and they're hard garbage. like you said.
So if Ted called and said, I'll give you a conditional six, that could like become a four if we win the Super Bowl. Wouldn't Baltimore?
Well, that's going to be pretty high for Ted. I would say conditional seven, it goes to like a six if they win the Super Bowl.
Okay, so it goes to like a six if they win the Super Bowl.
But still, a low draft pick that's a conditional low-round draft pick. Baltimore takes it. They have to take that deal, right? And Green Bay just eats up the rest of Smith's salary for the rest of the year.
And Smith, you know, like I said last night too, I know football isn't baseball where it's like, well, we'll just trade for a left fielder and plug him in and you're going to bat sixth. It's quite a bit harder. But like, again, the one thing this receiving core is lacking, even with everybody healthy, is that consistent deep threat. So even if Smith, who's a smart guy and I think could pick up the offense fairly quick.
And where they would put him in the offense wouldn't be that difficult to pick up.
Right, that's what I mean.
He's their deep threat.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Even if it takes him a while to learn sort of all of the intricacies of the offense, it wouldn't take him that long to be like, okay, Steve, on this play, you're going to go wide right. Aaron's going to drop back on a play action, you know, the Jordy Nelson shot play. Aaron's going to drop back on a play action. You're going to run as fast as you can in a straight line, and Aaron's going to get you the ball. I mean, I might be oversimplifying it a little bit, but like, but maybe not by that much. Like, it wouldn't be that hard to have Smith come in and just run some go routes.
No, it wouldn't. And it makes too much sense. And if you want, I know a lot of people made the comparison to this team, to the 96 team of all the injuries, and they have a running back, and they have a quarterback in his prime, blah, 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 like all these comparisons. Well, one thing that they haven't really compared yet that we can't really make is Mr. Ron Wolf made a trade for kind of a hothead, controversial type receiver at the back end of his career that helped win the Super Bowl.
Indeed he did, Adam.
And Steve Smith is kind of an Andre Rison type.
Oh, yeah. Oh, he totally is. He's insane. He's batshit crazy. But like,
just saying.
And Florio was right when he said that this team sometimes struggles a little bit in these single game eliminations in the playoffs, and that Smith's toughness and his sort of willingness to get in anybody's face and challenge them would be an asset for the Packers. I agree. I was like, when I was reading that, I was like, he's right. Like, Ted won't do it. We'll just toss that out there now. Ted's not going to do it because Ted doesn't ever do stuff like this, but he should.
That would be fun.
I just want to get your thoughts on that, because I was like, you know, it's something I've been kicking around in my brain the last...
Well, you know my thoughts, and you know the thoughts about most other Packers fans. I mean, the big thing I think that actually could sway this in all of our favors is that Steve Smith is retiring at the end of the year. There's no long-term commitment. You're not going to kill your cap. You're not going to have to give up any really draft picks of value to Baltimore. I mean... Even a condition of a pick is only going to drop it down to the fifth or sixth round. I mean, Baltimore traded a sixth round pick to San Francisco for Anquan Boldin. You know, I mean, San Francisco, vice versa.
Right.
But they're not going to go much at all. They're just going to eat Smith's salary the rest of the year, which is what, I don't know how much he's making, but it's only going to be a few million bucks.
That's a good point. That would play, you'd have to think that would maybe make Ted consider it.
If Smith didn't say he was returning this year and, you know, he potentially could play another couple of years, I'd say there's not a chance in hell. The fact they don't have to worry about him at the end of the year. Like, he's done. He's retiring. Like, it's not going to kill our future. We're not going to take any really major reps. Right, I heard the development of any of the young receivers. Well, one, because Montgomery's hurt and Adams is hurt, so whose development are you going to hurt here?
Right. No, I agree. And I just think, like...
It makes too much sense, and therefore
it's not
going to happen.
And like you said, like, he's retiring, you wouldn't have to worry about, like, oh, who's going to be the number one guy next year, him or Jordy or Cobb, and are there too many cooks in the kitchen now? You wouldn't have to worry about any of that shit, because whether he retires or not, it's a this-year thing.
Yeah, and even if he does say, you know what, I'm going to come back, and they're just going to cut him.
I'll just go, all right, well, we'll let you go somewhere else. Because Baltimore, yeah. I'm like 95% sure Baltimore is going to trade him, because... It's just a waste of time to have Smith on your team if you're gonna end up having one of the top 10 picks in the draft.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just something I've been thinking about. I was like, you know what? I'd do it.
If only we were the GMs.
No, we're so good at this. Clearly.
But do they really need Steve Smith? Since everyone's favorite receiver, Jeff Janis, made his first impact of the season.
You know, he's starting to get a little bit more involved in the offense. Yeah. I mean, at least there's some hope maybe that he'll be at least a decent receiver someday.
I'm not that excited.
He's really good on special teams, though. Holy
I know he
shit,
is.
Man. He is great. He is so good on special teams. Every week he makes plays.
He's like the second coming of Steve Tasker.
And you know what? For a seventh-round pick out of Saginaw Valley State, that's pretty good.
And I've already said this already. If all he does is make this impact as a gunner on special teams, and he's down there at every single kick, if that's where he makes his mark as a seventh-round pick, it's high return the value.
Oh, yeah, huge return on investment. Absolutely. But, I mean, it is a little – you watch his offense on Sunday, and it's like, Justin Perillo, Jared Aberderis, Jeff Janis. I'm like, this isn't how we drew this up back in August. I think the other thing about the offense that kind of bummed me out on Sunday was there was so much of an emphasis early on in the game. Early in the game they went short, and then it sort of felt like after they got that lead, it was like, all right, we're going to start to push this ball downfield. And it's like, you guys, you're not a deep passing offense. It was frustrating. It felt like Rodgers was being too stubborn there with trying to get the ball downfield. And then as soon as they went back to the short stuff in the second half, the offense started clicking again. That's just one sort of concern I have. I'm hoping that when these guys all start getting healthy, that will fix itself. But I guess I'm kind of worried at the moment that, like, Rodgers is starting to get frustrated with the short stuff and he's starting to kind of want to get out and run a little bit, you know?
Yeah, Rodgers wants to make plays.
He likes to swing for the fences.
They just don't have the offense built right now. Talk about the short plays. One guy I thought who would definitely be involved more the last couple weeks with all the injuries, even more so with Montgomery being out in the running game not really being a factor, is can I see Paige and Richard Rodgers? He has a handful of catches the last couple weeks, but he really hasn't made any sort of impact. I figured that'd be the one beneficiary of this offense.
You know, and I'm kind of worried. Not worried about him. That's not the right way to put it, but, you know, McGinn said it best about him. He's a catch and fall down guy. I was kind of hoping we'd see more from him at this point.
We haven't, and we ripped on the decision of putting Corliss on short-term IR to return. I'm not saying our course is going to make or break this offense, but I'm kind of longing to see some Andrew Corliss in there because Rodgers hasn't done much, and God forbid if we have to rely on Perillo and Bachman to make any plays.
You know, I wonder if Corliss wasn't more valuable. I'm glad you brought that up because I've been starting to wonder lately if Corliss isn't a little bit more valuable than we thought.
I think it's pretty obvious.
That maybe his presence sort of takes some of the load off of Rodgers, and then, you know, with Corliss being out, Rodgers has had to be the guy there, and maybe he's just not ready for that yet. Like, with Corliss here, Corliss can be that veteran leader of the group. And with him out, it's like, all right, second-year guy, you're the leader of the group. And maybe Rodgers just isn't ready to handle that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, maybe we do need Corliss back more than I thought.
When does he do back again? I forget.
Oh, shit. I think he has to be out 8 weeks. Okay, I think it's right around Thanksgiving. Right around Thanksgiving, early December, he can come back. So that's not good. If I was to ask you, since we're, like you said, this is as close to a mid-season show as we're going to do. We'll have some fun here. If I was to ask you, let's start with the offense. Mm-hmm. Who's been your most disappointing offensive performer, and who's surprised you the most in a good way?
Man. I'm gonna take on the first question first.
Disappointing.
Actually, let's go with surprising, because I think that's easy.
Yeah, pleasant surprise and disappointing surprise.
James Jones. I don't think there's without a question. I mean, we all know he was going to be a factor when they brought him back. Like, he knew the offense, but I don't think anyone with a straight face can expect what Jones has provided to this team.
You know why I think with Jones? Because I was one of the first faces he saw when he got back to Green Bay.
You rubbed your good mojo.
I think
on him.
That's what I think. He caught the good wedding weekend vibes from my wife and I when we saw each other in the elevator bank at the Spring Hill Suites in Green Bay. I think he caught some of those good vibes, and when I shook his hand, it transferred to Jones.
That could be fair.
I just wanted to remind all the listeners that I saw James Jones. So yeah, I'm back to serious. Yeah, James Jones, he's been great. Everything he could have hoped for and more.
Yes, without a doubt.
424 yards. I'm looking at the stats now. 424 yards, and he's averaging 20 yards a catch. Holy crap. So that probably won't hold. But if it was, he's on pace to, what, 800? Oh, about 1,000 yards receiving, so.
Yeah, disappointing player on the offense? I got a few of them, but I'm just going to pick one.
Yeah.
David Bakhtiari.
Yeah.
Balaga's been disappointing, but you can blame that on injuries. Lindsay's kind of sophomore slump. I don't know what Bakhtiari's excuse is.
He's
been bad.
He's definitely struggled. Yeah, I that's not a bad choice. He hasn't been quite as terrible last, but yeah, I mean.
All the other disappointments, I can kind of blame an injury. I mean, Lacy's been disappointed,
but
he's been hurt.
It's tough to pick on offense because Lacy's been hurt, Cobb's been hurt, Adams has been hurt.
I mean, based on a talent level of production output, yeah, it's Eddie Lacy, but I don't feel like it's Lacy's fault entirely of why he's been bad the last few weeks.
No, I agree.
So that's why I'm going with Bakhtiari.
Those are good choices. My, you know what? I don't even know if I would name any just because I think you did so well. I can't really think.
Oh, thank you.
I just can't. Oh, no problem. I just can't think of any. You know what? I'll go. You know what? I will go with a pleasant surprise. I will. James Starks. I think I thought coming into the season they had a pretty good 1-2 punch, and I thought Starks was a pretty good, number two option. But you nailed it earlier when you said he is probably the best backup running back in football, or one of them.
Yeah.
And I didn't really rank him. I guess I didn't really have him in that high esteem coming into the season. But he's really shown. I was thinking about it during the game on Sunday. He's really quietly very valuable to this team. Not just this year, but throughout his career as a Packer.
Mm-hmm.
He's been really valuable. Like, you could do a lot worse than James Starks. So I'll say him as my pleasant surprise. And my disappointment, I'm just going to go with all the injuries. My disappointment is injuries robbing us of what we expected to see out of Lacy and Cobb and Devontae.
We see all this bad stuff. We're still 6-0.
6-0. 6-0, baby.
Counts for something.
All right, defense. It's got to be Raji, right?
Yeah. Even with the injury, got to be the big man.
I think he's been the second most valuable player on this team, behind, obviously, Aaron Rodgers.
Even more so than Matthews?
Well, that might be
Matthews
a tie.
Matthews has been pretty damn
spot.
Good this year. Yeah.
It might be a tie. Because I think so much of what Matthews has done is because of Raji.
Yeah. There's definitely a correlation there.
Yeah, I Raji's been fantastic. There's been so many pleasant surprises on the defense, though. Even though we just ripped the shit out of him for like the first hour or whatever it was of the show tonight.
A lot of it is directed towards Dom
yeah.
Capers.
There's been so many pleasant surprises so far. You know, Nate Palmer's been quietly pretty good. Obviously, J-Rone, his impact has lessened a little bit here in these last couple weeks, but J-Rone's been good. Demarius Randall has already making plays.
And that leads to my disappointment, since we're talking about the D-backs.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm about to cut you off. I think we're seeing the Packers have ideally 13 more games left, right? 10 in the regular season, 3 in the playoffs.
Yes.
Kind of Super Bowl.
Yes.
Does Casey Hayward see a 14th?
No.
No. I don't think there's – unless he somehow turns around drastically.
And when you say drastically, like he has to really like pick off like 3 or 4 passes and become a real factor. I'm looking at Hayward's stat line now. 2 passes defended. No picks.
That's oh. – And he's already been passed on the depth chart by the two rookies. And once Burnett gets back, I don't see a set. If once Burnett's healthy and there's no more injury secondary, I don't see a set where Hayward really sees a field because they'll move Hyde back to corner.
And Randall has been too good to bump out of the rotation.
Oh, no. And Rollins has made a lot of plays.
And Rollins has earned more playing time. Yes.
Once Burnett gets healthy, it's going to be awfully, awfully hard for Casey Hayward to see this field, barring more injuries.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think I think he's done. I think this is it for Hayward, because he's a guy that you know when you get to March, even if he doesn't have a great year statistically, and this team, like, wins the Super Bowl, which we all hope, Hayward will be able to say, well, you know, I logged pretty good minutes, to use a hockey term, on a championship-winning team, and in the past I've put up big numbers. So somebody's going to overpay for him.
Yeah, someone's going to put on the tape of his rookie year and realize, holy crap, this guy has potential to get 6 or 7 picks a year. And then they fail to realize that he hasn't done squat since his rookie year.
Right. I don't think this is – I don't think Casey Hayward will be back. No. Because Randall's just been so good.
He has, and he's gotten better every
week.
Right,
he's getting better every week. And Rollins got into the rotation against St. Louis and had 2 picks, including a pick 6. And then kind of fell off a little bit last week. But you know what else? You know, we're talking about pleasant surprises. You know what else has been a pleasant surprise? Hotbox.
He has.
Hotbox Jones. That was his best game as a pro on Sunday. He was great.
Something's finally clicking for Hotbox.
And I wonder, do you think it's just health?
I think that has a lot to do with it.
Because he's been kind of dogged by ankle injuries his first couple years.
I think it's health. I think it's experience. I think you see so many guys, especially on this team, to make impacts as rookies that, you know, sometimes it takes 2 or 3 years for guys to catch up in the NFL.
That's true. We are used to Ted's guys making a mark right away.
And we've seen that with other players. I mean, you look at a Mike Neal, Nick Perry, for example. And I mean, Perry and Neal are also motivated by money, but Neal really came in his own a couple years ago. You look at like a Randall Cobb type who – yeah, made his mark as a rookie, as a returner. Didn't really do anything until his second year. There's other guys in the list, too. Burnett had his up and downs early on in his career. Whereas I think Hotbox is just – he's finally coming in his own. I think it took him a little longer to catch on at the speed of the game and get health. I mean, health had a huge factor in it. So he's healthy. He's a little more experienced, and this is what you're seeing.
And I think
– some guy practice a little patience.
Yeah, and I think also he is sort of – growing into his role, you know, he's found a I think it took a while for this team to sort of figure out where to use him, and they sort of have focused on using him as an interior rusher.
Yeah,
and I think now that he's sort of growing more and more comfortable with his role, I think that's helped too.
Yeah, he's definitely up there for pleasant surprise.
Yeah,
because I'm
really excited, and I'm excited to see where he goes as the season progresses. But Hayward, I mean, I feel like Hayward's kind of the only guy in the defense that's really disappointed me.
Yeah, based on expectations.
Based on what we thought, right. I can't think of anybody else where I've been like, oh, he's been terrible. There's no Jared Bushes on the defense, you know what I mean?
No, there's no one based on where we thought they would be.
Yeah, everybody's either at or exceeding expectations.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
So it's good. I mean, and that's a good sign. And special teams, we talked a little bit about Janis. I feel like that's been an area, too, where they've made a lot of strides.
Yeah, you look at some of the guys they've really plugged in on those coverage teams. And
Banjo.
Wow.
Janis.
What a difference a couple of those guys have made.
Yeah, Banjo and Janis in particular both look like special team studs. And, you know, Ripkowski and Jake Ryan and those guys too. I really think that Zook's done a nice job with that group. And I think we talked about it after the draft too, that they drafted a lot of guys who could play special teams. It was definitely kind of a referendum on where they were in that area of their game. And you're seeing it make an impact.
Yeah.
And I think the return game's going to get better. I think Montgomery's going to get better. Aberderis has done a nice job. Did a nice job filling in on Sunday. I think they're going to. That's one area of the team where I am pretty excited about. Outside of Tim Mastay, I guess. But he's been better. He's been better lately.
He has been bad.
He's been better lately.
He's been average. He's been sufficient. That's about all you can ask for.
Yeah.
Well, do you have anything else to?
I was just
going to
say, is there anything else? I feel like we kind of.
I'm kind of running out of gas.
We talked about making this a free-form thing where we were just going to kind of empty our mental notebooks and just put out whatever gripes we had or thoughts we had. I can't think of anything else.
It kind of feels like we've been meandering through the neighborhood, through the trees, on this long road trip that really didn't have a map.
Right.
And now we're at the point where we just need to fill up for gas. I don't think we drove around in circles. I think we just kind of – we found our way home and we'll be back next week.
Yeah, I can't really – I mean, I'm like even now I'm like, well, was there anything else? Is there anything else that I really was like, oh, I got to get this out there? I don't think there is.
No.
I hope you guys enjoyed it. Give yourself a round of applause if you made it to the end.
Enjoy your bye week.
Yep, and we will be back. Well, I'm stepping on your toes here. You do this.
I said we'll be back next week to preview Broncos Packers battle of 2 undefeated teams. Probably the best matchup CNN. NBC's had on Sunday Night Football in a while.
It's a great. I mean, it's such a good matchup. Michaels was already talking about it last week during the Pats Colts game.
Well, geez, they've had some dog shit matchups last.
Well, what's their game this week? Well, Carolina Philly. Well, that's not very good.
Not very enticing. I mean, Indy and New England's fine. I mean, if Indy wasn't such a garbage fire this year. But this still has, I mean, there's enough storylines. But then they had Giants, 49ers, Cowboys, Saints. There's been some real stinkers. And the NFL knows this. You can flex in a game starting week 5.
Yeah.
They just haven't – they have – from week 5 to 10, I think it is, they get 2 flex matchups.
Yep.
And then from week 10 on, they can flex in whoever they want.
Yeah, it's really –
Except for a couple of protected games. And you look at some of the matches last couple weeks, I'm like, I'm not sure anyone really wants to see the Niners and Giants. I mean, yeah, New York market. But I've been kind of looking at the schedule. I'm like, could the Packers get flexed in any of these games? There's some potential for the Packers to be flexed in for more than one more Sunday night game this year.
Oh, I think they're going to be on at least once more. Yeah, definitely. And that week, I mean, that week 17 game against the Vikings, which I also have tickets to, that may end up being a game I think they could get flexed in.
Oh, yeah, the last two games of the season at Arizona, that could have a big impact.
You got to think that Arizona game is going to be on Sunday night, right?
Well, you'd hope so.
Unless as long as Palmer and Rodgers stay healthy, I got to think that game gets flexed in. Or at least NBC's going to do everything they can to get it.
Well, on week 16, the Sunday night game right now is Steelers at Ravens, and everyone loves a good rival, but that's...
But the Ravens, right, the Ravens
are so bad.
That's week 16?
Yeah.
Shit, the Ravens might be like 4-11 going into that game, or
4-10. They can't just for that. And the other really good matchup that week is Bengals at Broncos, but that's on Monday night.
So they...
And I'm looking at... Patriots and Jets could be one possibility. Falcons, Panthers at Falcons could be another. But there's some good options for week 16. But that's the Packers have to, I mean, you have to think maybe that's the game, one of the games that, because Fox and CBS get 2 games that they can protect. And they're already going to protect the Packers-Cowboys game in December.
Yep.
Like, that's a guarantee they're going to protect that game.
Oh, yeah.
That game's not moving to Sunday night. So maybe Cardinals and Packers does. But, I mean, a lot's going to be, it's going to be played out. But week 17 for sure, because
I don't think I don't think that game will decide the division. At least I freaking hope not.
But it could be if the Vikings win, they're in the playoffs.
And it could be right. It could be Vikings win, they're in. Packers win, they get home field advantage throughout. Like there could be a couple of really big things at stake in that game. So I think I agree that I think they're going to be flexed onto Sunday night at least once more. Like I said, Al Michaels was already talking about the Bronco game. He was like, well, you know, and after tonight, Chris, we've got Panthers and Eagles next Sunday. He's like, and then after that, he's like, Broncos, Packers. And then he spent what felt like 5 minutes talking about the game.
Well, hopes that both teams are going to buy this week, so they're going to come in healthy and they're both going to be undefeated.
Right. It was just funny to hear Michaels basically shit on the Panthers and Eagles and go right to the Packer game. I was like, yeah, this is going to be a pretty hyped matchup. So it'll be fun to talk about that next week, and we can go down memory lane and talk about all the history between these two teams. There's a lot, good and bad. So
if the Packers and Panthers both win next week, or the next 2 weeks, I should say, or even if the Panthers lose one, the Packers beat the Broncos, could they put the Packers in Sunday Night Football 2 weeks in a row? Has that been done before besides week 16, 17?
I think it's been done. Well, they have to give 12 days notice, right? I think that's the rule. You have to have 12 days.
Yeah, so say
so what
Carolina
is the Carolina, the Carolina game is
Sunday night. So they beat Carolina because they'll have to know before the Packers and Broncos even play next week or 2 weeks from now.
Yeah, Packers, if they were going to move Carolina and Green Bay –
We'd have to know this upcoming
Tuesday night. Yeah, by Tuesday afternoon at close of business, they would have to announce that they're going to flex. So
say Carolina beats Philly and they're undefeated after this week. The Sunday night game, no, they're not going to win because they're
– What is it?
It's going to be another shitty Sunday game, but it's going to get ratings. It's Eagles at Cowboys. Sam Bradford, Matt Castle, giddy up.
You know, I get that NBC – I mean, it's a sound business strategy to be like, well – the NFL is so completely unpredictable from year to year. So we want to make sure that even if we get, you know what I'm saying? How do I say this? Like, they go for markets more than teams that they think might be good. Because it's like, well, even if the Eagles and Giants suck by the time that week 8 game rolls around, well, at least we're going to get Philly and New York TV markets. Which I guess is a sound business strategy, but it's a little bit annoying as a viewer to be like, It feels like every other week it's some sort of NFC East matchup or San Francisco.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, God forbid if LA ever does get an NFL team, shit, you know they're going to be like the game of the week every other week.
Yeah.
LA, New York.
Green Bay and Charlotte really does nothing for the needle nation-wise, market-wise, but that's the best game of the week in two weeks,
probably.
But
that's the game, right. That's the game football fans want to see, I would think, more than some NFC East shit.
Another chance for Sunday Night Football, since we're just looking for a way to extend this podcast.
Yeah, if you guys are still listening,
I love looking at schedules
high five.
So much.
Yeah, this is fun. I hope you guys are enjoying this. We're just gonna go a little bit longer.
Week 11, Packers at Vikings, noon start. Sunday Night game that week, which they have to flex out. It's Chiefs at Chargers.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Holy shit.
The only other possible matchups they could probably flex in, well, they're not going to flex in 49ers Seahawks because both those teams are going to be bad, and that's a late game on Fox. Fox probably want to keep that game late.
Do you ever read Drew McGarry's Jamboree on Thursdays on Deadspin?
Oh, yeah.
Did you read it today where he was talking about how the Chiefs...
No, I missed it. I haven't read it yet today.
The Chiefs have sped through the Andy Reid cycle faster than normal, and they've already gone to the... I can't remember what term he used, but it was like the disappointing ending of the Andy Reid cycle way faster than anybody thought they would.
Yeah.
But anyways, Chiefs-Chargers...
Chiefs-Chargers, this is week 11, so this is...
And each network at this point can protect how many games? One?
Two.
Two,
they can play two late afternoon games, I believe. I'm not saying Niners and Seahawks will get moved, even if that's not even protected. Fox is probably not protecting that game anyways. But there's not a lot going to – I mean, this is – we're looking a month ahead from now. So the Vikings do have to
pull up their right. But if the Vikings hold their own and are good, I could see NBC wanting that game. Outdoors, it'll be kind of cold by then in Minnesota and, like,
you know, the Packers bigger rivals. Packers by week 11, say they're 9-1, and the Vikings are 6-4 at that point, maybe.
I could see them picking that game up.
There's only one other decent game that week, Bengals at Cardinals.
Because the networks do seem to like Packers-Bears and Packers-Vikings.
They do like the rivalry
games. And with Green Bay, those are the two big ones. Not the Lions, but those two opponents, they do like to put those on prime time if they can.
And Bengals and Cardinals might be a better game, but they're not really strong market teams, and
right.
they're just out of conference, and that's a late afternoon game on CBS. CBS actually might want to protect that game. That'd be a good one. So week 11's possibility. So we're looking at week 9, Panthers, week 11, Vikings. Skipping across here. Week 12 that's Thanksgiving's week 12.
They play two Thursday night games in a row, week 12 and 13, right?
15. Yep, and week 14 is the Cowboys game.
Which, you know, that's getting protected.
Week 15, they're playing – who are they playing? Yep, Oakland,
that's not going to get moved.
Then Arizona, week 16 and week 17 at the Vikings.
So as many as four possibilities at flex games, right? We're saying Carolina, Minnesota, Arizona, and then Minnesota again.
Minnesota again. And week 17 can be a crapshoot because – you have matchups like the Eagles and Giants that could decide a division. You have
probably will. NBC is probably going to go with the NFC East game,
and that
determines
and
which
that
garbage 8-8 team gets in.
Well, you also have the Seahawks and Cardinals. Seahawks would be fighting for a playoff spot.
That would be a good one. The defending NFC champs fighting for their playoff lives. Yeah,
Jets and Bills, Patriots, Dolphins, or some other. Decent ones. But week 17, I'm not going to talk about week 17 because it could be a garbage matchup, but if that determines Christ. It could be Titans and Colts if the Colts need a win to get to 7-9 and win the AFC South.
That's true.
You know?
Because NBC has held pretty firm on week 17, we don't care about records. We care about which game has the biggest playoff implications.
Remember, this is probably like 5 or 6 years ago when they had. Wasn't it the 7-8 Rams versus the 7-8 Seahawks?
It was 2010 because I just wrote about this for WTMJ. That was the night, the week before, Gino and I went to the Packers-Giants game that kicked off the Super Bowl run, right? That kicked off the 6 in a row to win Super Bowl 45. And we were wondering if they were going to put Packers-Bears. Gino and I were sitting in a McDonald's like somewhere like an hour away from Green Bay, I think. And we were wondering if they were going to put Packers-Bears on Sunday Night Football the next week. And they didn't. They went with Rams Seahawks.
Yeah, that, I mean, so that,
and that was, yeah, that was the six. Was it 6-9 versus a 7-8? Oh, yeah, it was.
I think they're both 7-8.
They're both 7-8 going to win the division.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. And then the Seahawks won, and then the next week beat the Saints, right?
I think so.
That was the Marshawn, and then that was the Marshawn Lynch run that shook the earth, and then yep, and then they lost to Chicago the next week, and then Green Bay. Yeah, there you go. That's a good way to end this.
Week 14. I'm going to extend one more. If they don't protect the Cowboys-Packers game, which I don't see that happening.
This is like a Bruce Springsteen concert. I'm going to keep going. One more.
I just passed over week 14. But if for some reason Fox doesn't protect that game, or the NFL strongly encourages, then sending a game for week 14, Seahawks at Ravens. So that's getting flexed out. And there's really only, we're only 6 weeks in. But doing some predictions, there's a few matchups. They're predicting that game. I'm like, well, they have Falcons and Panthers. That could be a good one. And they also have Steelers and Bengals to choose from.
I would think if you looked at all the potential matchups in the game in the NFL, I would think Packers-Cowboys has to be one of the top, not even five, but like top three, where whichever network gets it, like if Fox gets it, I should say. If Fox gets it, it's like, you're not taking this game from us. Over, you'll take this game out of our cold, dead hands. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And the only way I could see that being done, if there's crap, there's no other alternative options, but it looks like there's going to be a couple other ones that would be fine.
Like, Pats, Colts would be in that group, and I don't know what the third one would be. But I know Green Bay and Dallas has got to be a top three for, like, we're keeping this game. No one is taking this game from us.
Yeah, I agree.
Because it's just ratings. Dallas brings in ratings in the pack of their national teams.
Well, anyways, we'll end our Bruce Springsteen-esque podcast.
This was good. This was fun. I hope you guys enjoyed this. Like we said, we just freeformed the hell out of it. We had no game to preview. It was like, let's just go.
So if you checked out before our scheduled preview of when the Packers could get more Sunday night games, we don't blame you. That was actually just very, very impromptu.
You wanted to beat traffic. You wanted to beat traffic.
Yes.
You were like, I know he's going to do a few more songs, but it's kind of late, and it's like a Tuesday night, so I got to get going. But for those of you who stayed.
You timed out your podcast so you could listen to us on your way home or to and from home. You pull in the driveway. Your dog and your kids are looking out the window at you like, God damn it. All right, fine.
Where's Daddy?
I'll figure out the future schedule, Sunday night games on my own. Thanks, guys. Call it a night. Well, we'll call it a night, too. See you guys next week. Enjoy the week off. I'm Adam Somers.
And I'm Chris Lempesis.
This Green Bay Packers podcast is brought to you by Mayfield Sports Marketing, our official sports marketing agent for player appearances. To book a Packers player for your next event, go to PackersTalk.com and click on Player Appearances. Are you looking for some signed Packer memorabilia?
Look no further than Waukesha Sports Cards.
If the Green Bay Packer can sign it, Waukesha Sports Cards has it.
Check our website for upcoming Packer player and legend signing.
Go to WaukeshaSportsCards.com.